Welcome, everybody. Welcome. This is the activist groups have done stuff around the RIMPAC war games since I've lived on the island 12 years. But this is the second year of Oceans4Peace. Oceans4Peace is a coalition of groups that have put together an educational program to let people know about RIMPAC and its impacts on our island and on the world and on the ocean. My name's Gordon Labedz. I'm on the board of a number of conservation groups. And tonight we're going to have a panel, because when we started our first Oceans4Peace meeting, people started throwing things out, and we realized we needed to educate ourselves about what's going on in RIMPAC so that we can educate others in the community. And that's the goal for tonight. We're going to educate ourselves so that we can educate our friends and the people we know. Get over the thing. What's RIMPAC? What's that? You know, we need to elevate the level of understanding of the island about what the Navy is doing to the ocean. So, without much further ado, we've got three panelists. You guys don't want to sit all up here?
Oh, I see you, show.
Oh, yeah, that's right. Okay. That's true. Yeah, you don't have to sit. The speakers don't have to sit. But the concept of the panel will be, our speakers are going to speak briefly, and then we're going to have a discussion amongst all of us. It can be questions or statements or whatever. I'm going to call on you, though. We're not going to. If I point to you, that means you can speak. We're not going to have a free for all. Our first speaker, I think I'll just introduce as we go along. Okay, our first speaker is Kalsara Satasia. She's in a group that I'm very much involved in. We have a table back there, Kohola Leo. Kohola is humpback whale. Leo is voice. Roughly translated in Hawaiian, it means voice of the sea. Humpback whale is a very sacred animal to the Hawaiian culture. And Kalsara is going to talk about impacts that the Navy has on whales. So, Kalsara, you want to come up and have your little clicker?
I have a clicker.
Yeah.
Hi, everyone. Thanks for coming. So that was my first slide, what Gordon just said. So Hawaii has about 20 species of whales. Now, we all know the humpback, and we all know that they're not here in the summer, but there's several that are here year-round and are affected by the Navy's exercises throughout the year. Most of them live in the deep water, so they're far offshore. We don't see them very often. Others just pass through and swim by, and others hang out more towards the outer island chain and then come down once in a while, such as the orcas. They come down and visit the main islands every couple years. Now, even though many of the whales are recovering in populations, they still face tremendous challenges. And net entanglements are their biggest challenge, but today I'm going to focus on boat collisions, sonar, and other ocean noises, because this would apply to the Navy in general as well. So vessel strikes are quite common, mostly up the east coast of Alaska and the west coast of the Pacific, but we do have vessel strikes here in Hawaii too. And most of the time, the strikes are when the boats are going 10 to 19 knots. And in California, two whales have come into harbor on the bow of a large ship. I think there's a button here, like this, and kill them. Now, some of the Navy ships, oh, and this is a propeller injuries. Where's the clicker? So most Navy ships go between 30 up to 40 knots. They don't travel this speed all the time, But for RIMPAC, we have 27 countries bringing ships here, and they will be doing exercises, sometimes at fast speeds. So it could be a factor that they could hit marine life, and none of us would know that. Kohalaleo requests 14 knots or less to avoid hitting whales. But
would they even know if they hit one?
It's hard to say. It depends on the size of the ship and how fast they're going. Other noises, anthropogenic noises, are things like oil drilling and cruise ships and cargo ships and tankers. And the decibel levels I have here, and the military ships are about the same as these ships. And human hearing becomes painful at 125 decibels. So when you have RIMPAC coming here with all the ships zooming around, it's adding a lot of noise to the oceans. The biggest noise threat, though, is the mid-frequency sonar that the Navy uses. Now, what they do is to detect silent submarines. So what they'll do is they'll send a sound out with an array to hit the submarine and then bounce it back to the ship so that the ship can find these silent submarines. This will be included in the war games that they play here. And this is what it sounds like. Sorry, my speaker is not very loud, but imagine that 10,000 times louder than a 747 taking off. Yeah. Here's a short blast. You see it's real piercing? Mm-hmm. Well, here are some of the effects that this sound has. Trauma, hemorrhaging, stress, bleeding from the ears and the eyes. I'm sorry for the gruesome pictures. Many mass strandings around the planet are related to sonar exercises. In July of 2004, during RIMPAC, there were a bunch of melon-headed whales, over 200, that came into Hanalei Bay, terrified. Now, these are deep-sea whales. They don't normally come near shore. So for them to come in was a big deal. And I don't believe there were any deaths, and people came together and helped them back out to sea, but the Navy did admit that it was because of them that they came in. And then 2014 in Hanalei, we had a pilot whale pass away in Hanalei Bay. And a few days later on Oahu, another melon-headed whale passed away, all during the time of RIMPAC. So it is a problem. And I know that Oceans4Peace has a number to call during the exercises. So if you do see any unusual behavior from marine life, you can call and we'll get that number out to you. So the Navy wants to also extend their training range from Hawaii to California. And they went through a process and got permits, take permits to kill, harass, and maim several million whales over a five-year period. They were taken to court, and they were illegally given the permits because they had not done the EIS properly and taken into consideration the real threats of their exercises. So the Navy said they would agree not to do sonar in certain areas of Hawaii. They did exclude Hawaii altogether. And they are currently working on a new EIS to start the process for permitting all over again. So on this map, here's Maui and Molokai. They said they would not do sonar on the eastern parts of the islands. And same with Big Island. They would not do sonar on the eastern part, and they would limit it between the channel. However, this is where they don't do sonar anyway. So they didn't actually give up anything, just so you know. And I just want to touch base real quick on DARPA. They are the Defense Advanced Research Projects Agency. I don't know if you've heard of them. They are exempt from the rest of the military, and they are a part of the Defense Department. They report directly to the Defense Department. They have their own budget of over $2 billion every year, and they do research and technology that basically no one else can do. They are exempt from the environmental laws and EISs. And in their mission statement, the last sentence says, DARPA has been the place for people with ideas too crazy, too far out, too risky for most research organizations. DARPA is an organization willing to take a risk on an idea long before it is proven. DARPA was part of RIMPAC in 2014. They brought all these robotic technologies for the military to try out and play with. Many of them actually didn't work out. But some are, and they have microtechnology of mosquito-looking bugs, robots. And I mean, if you go to their website, there's tons of stuff. But what I found interesting is today I saw an article about a new project DARPA is doing. They're calling it the Poseidon Program. And what they want to do is plant these speakers in a grid pattern across all the oceans to blast sound 24/7, because GPS doesn't go underwater. So the submarines have no accurate way of telling exactly where they are. It's kind of a guesswork. But with these, they will be able to broadcast locations. So as the ships are coming through, and the unmanned drones and the unmanned submarines that DARPA is developing, they will always know where they are. But this is just adding sound to the ocean on top of everything else that we're already doing. So thank you very much.
And she's got a website called ourwaterdrop.org. And she's going to talk about the effects on corals. Are we all set up?
Okay.
Katie, thanks.
And it was up on play, but thank you, Oceans4Peace and Kalasara. I went to the original meeting for Oceans4Peace completely hopeless. I was only going because 2 years ago I gave a talk and I thought, we can't stop the military. But there were so many people there that were so thrilled to learn more about RIMPAC that I decided to speak yet again. So I've become what I call undemoralized. No longer hopeless, I'm undemoralized. And I want to thank Oceans4Peace then for bringing in new people, and especially my young friends like Taylor and you. Thanks. And I'm inspired by my friends in Okinawa. Some of you know I moved here from Japan 5 years ago, and I'm helping the Okinawans defend their last coral reef from the American military. We're marching tomorrow. There are going to be tens of thousands of people marching against the Marines. We're trying to get the Marines out of Okinawa. The American military has been there for 70 years, and they have the biggest burden in Okinawa. And so if 85-year-old ladies and men can fight the American military, I can too. So I'm dedicating this talk to them. So we have a choice here, harm or harmony. I have, as he mentioned, I have a project offshore here, and I see turtles every day. And today's talk is about sound, harmony. Sound is important to humans, but not as much as our visual senses. But animals really depend on sound. So here's, look, I only have 10 minutes to tell you 68 years of experience. This is my mother and my brother and me wearing a hand-me-down swimsuit. I'm trying to be a turtle. And so I love the ocean, and I'm in awe of ocean life. And I love, this is my favorite place in the world, a warm, comforting, blue, clean sea. So I invite you to come into the sea with me. And this is what I studied in Puerto Rico as a kid. These are sea fans. They respond to currents, and they're living animals. And this has to do with dancing in the sea and listening to sounds. And if you come near them, they can feel your presence and they retract. So they're very sensitive to sound. So I became a marine biologist because I wanted to spend my life in the water looking at beautiful creatures. This is me in a submarine in 1977 in Hawaii. My PhD is on deep water corals here. So I went down to 1,500 feet in the submarine and saw hundreds of new species here. It's a forest. From 1,200 feet, as far as you can see, down, 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 there are so many corals. They're unnamed. They're new species, undescribed. This is one I described, Lepidisus olapa music. And it's a bamboo coral. If you look closely, you can see white, brown, white, brown. It's a flexible coral that does that. And with the current, it goes this way and then the other way. The oldest one in the Hawaiian chain is 4,000 years old, a bamboo coral. And I mentioned this oculina is a kind of reef coral. Lophelia, these are 4,000-year-old reefs we're talking about. Other species in the ocean are the one that you have at home, Kip and Sharon, is 2,700 years old. These are animals in the Hawaiian chain that are thousands of years old. And then the last, since 1971, we've been obliterating them with the Navy exercises. This is a close-up. I study octocorals, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. They have 8 tentacles. This is to show you, these are about the size of about a millimeter, and they're very fragile, very tiny creatures. And so Kalasar did a wonderful job talking about the whales, so my job is to speak up for the tiny things in the ocean that are very, very sensitive to sound. Gorgeous umbellula. They're so pretty, and new species. This is a black coral. One of the black corals is 2,400 years old. The gold coral, 2,400 years old. They grow very slowly. They're very down deep, deep in the dark and cold. So they grow slowly. This has only 6 tentacles, so it's a different group of animals related to the hexacorals. All tiny, fragile creatures. And they form gardens under the sea. So the corals are important because they're homes for the fish. And this is in the coral reefs of the tropical shallow water. You're used to seeing photos like this. This is an octocoral, by the way, Dendronephia. The oculina beds and the lophelia beds in Norway, in the Caribbean, and off our coast are home to fishes. 85% of the commercial fishes of Alaska have part of their life cycle on the deep sea corals. In Florida, the oculina reefs are for bass and grouper. They're very important in the life cycle of other creatures. They're animals. The females have eggs, and they cast them out. And when they meet the sperm, they make a baby called a planula. This is only about a millimeter long. And these planula can swim around. They use their little cilia, and they can swim. They're very tiny. And if you watch, a girl in Florida put a bowl of these in Nira. She had a bowl of planula babies, and she played the sounds of a reef over here, and they all swam over to the sounds of the reef. They have no eyes, no ears, but they're sensitive to sound. And when they find a nice place to live, they settle down, and then they start to grow. And they make a mouth, and they make 8 tentacles in the case of mine, and then they make a skeleton. And in the case of these deep sea corals, they grow less than a millimeter a year. That's how they calculate how old they are. The one that's 4,000 years old is 5 feet tall, I guess. My point being that they respond to sound, they care about pressures. Once they've settled, they build a skeleton, they have a mouth and tentacles, and they grow. And they make beautiful corals, and then they attract fishes in their homes to all these other important creatures. I looked up deep sea reproduction. There's one paper on the internet. This reproductive periodicity and spawning of flabellum. Almost nothing is known about the reproduction. This one forms gametes in June, and it spawns the next year in the fall. It's possible that these animals are reproducing right at the time of RIMPAC here. So it's a critical time for these animals. Many animals depend on sound. This is a stomatopod. a young woman in Florida was studying these. These are fantastic. It's mantis shrimp. They look like a praying mantis. They're very quick to slam things to kill them. They rumble just like elephants. Males live in a tunnel and females live in a tunnel, and they come out at dawn and they rumble to speak to each other. It's the dawn chorus. And she found when she was recording them, she could distinguish individuals. She found that when a cargo ship, remember, Colasera said cargo ships, which is why I don't belong to Costco, cargo ships, cruise ships, Navy, all these sounds, the animals are quiet. They don't feed, they don't talk to each other, they are silent. So a lot of animals in the sea are affected by the sounds, and we're really polluting their environment. Crabs get really crabby. They can't think, and they don't eat when the sounds come by. They show that fish, their metabolism rises. They have to eat more. It's very disturbing to all these creatures. So not just the whales and not just the corals, a lot of little creatures. It's amazing. This is the peacock, stomatobon. And I got this from a Hawaiian plankton soup article, Litschwager. This is one splash of seawater, has so many kinds of animals in it, in the plankton. So it isn't just the very deep, deep sea I'm talking about tonight, but all these animals in the shallow water, I mean, in the top of the sea, way far out there. This is a little pteropod. This is the side of a petri dish. Tiny, a little baby octopus. All these creatures in the water column are getting completely obliterated by sonar. It's terrifying. When I heard the news of the awful massacre in Florida, I could feel the tears starting to well up, and I go, I'm crying because it's a massacre underwater for these animals. They have no voice. No one's speaking for them. They speak to each other, but not to us. So this RIMPAC is going to be now 27 countries, 25,000 guys, countless ships and planes, and they have license to do what they want. Mitsubishi is a big swap fest. They're all looking at each other. China's coming, Brazil and Norway are coming. They're not even in the Pacific. Mitsubishi has just developed a new incredible amphibious tank that's so fast that it can run over coral reefs. It's just dreadful. Sonar, they ping to find an object, and then they get the sound back again to locate it. It can go as many as 20 kilometers underwater. So this is a chart that shows that the traffic we hear. We have injury around 90, motorcycles, power mowers. The pain begins at 125, as she mentioned, and this active sonar is up at 230. This is a logarithmic curve. It's unbelievable. So we have a choice, harm or harmony. And this turtle, actually, turtles have voices too. They hiss and talk to each other, especially when they're mating or courting. So all the animals care about sound, and I care about sound. So this was going to be my last slide, and porpita is a little tiny, about the size of a quarter, plankton, related to the Portuguese man of war. It reminded me of ourwaterdrop.org, my website. This is our water drop. And the earth is a water drop, and I'm a water drop, and you are all water drops. And I always tell the kids, we should be more like water. We should, when we meet, make waterfalls and rainbows instead of shooting each other. Kids get it pretty fast. I mean, whales can hear sounds completely across the Atlantic. The sound from pole to pole can be heard, you know. This is a huge, like a big sound box, our earth, but we're destroying it. So then I have, I put this on today because it was in the paper. This is hypocritical. We're putting up a new proposition for the monument. Here's Kauai. Right now there's this so-called protected zone, 50 miles. We're making it 200 miles wide. Not sure about this line. This is 36 longitude. Here's Kauai. Right now impact is occurring about 50 miles and further out. Just drawing a line doesn't stop the sound. This is about 150 miles from Kauai, this line. So it's hypocritical to say that we're going to protect the ocean and not have the fishermen out there, but we can have the Navy. So what to do? And One is the reason I'm here tonight, education. I go to the schools. Next Friday, I'm going to take my water drop story to the elementary school, and I'm going to add, it usually is water drop, floating in the sky, dropping to the sea, dancing in the waves, and now I'm going to have cringing from the sonar. And the other is to do something which is active. Kalasar and I are planning to go out in July in a boat and take measuring hydrophones out. And we're looking for a captain. She has a boat that can go out at first past Niihau. And anyone who wants to captain our boat and come with us, please help. There'll be more discussion tonight after Juan speaks about things we can do that are direct action, not just talking. Thank you. I forgot. I asked the Smithsonian for this is a list of 874 kinds of sea life around Kauai, collected from 1902 by the albatross up to 1977 by Grigg. There's so much out there that we haven't studied. No information about it. Nothing about its reproduction. Nothing. It's just amazing. And I'm not in the field of studying naming corals anymore. I'm worried about them dying, so we're doing education.
Foundation. I wanted to say a couple of things while they're getting hooked up. Oceans4Peace has a petition, which we have a paper petition over there by the COPA Law table, and it's on change.org. And if you are interested, the fourth Friday of every month in this room, COPA Law has a ocean movie, a whale movie. And this next Friday, we're going to show Sonic Sea, which is, I've seen it on television. It's very, very good. It's about what Catherine and Palasara have been talking about. We're going to show it in Kaloa at the Kaloa Neighborhood Center on Thursday, here on Friday, and in Princeville on Sunday. So I'm hoping you guys can at least catch one of those because it's really quite good. Are you hooked up?
Yes.
All right then. Oceans4Peace has a number of other projects, and if you're interested in getting involved, we're going to meet again, not this Monday, but the Monday after at the Lihue Library. You can sign up at that table out there. And we have a project of little postcards where kids are going to draw pictures of whales and sea life, and we're going to send them in to our pro-military congressional representatives and let them know that there's voices for peace and for peace in the ocean. So Juan Wilson is most famously known for islandbreath.org. Lots of people, they drink their morning coffee at islandbreath.org. You want to know what's going on. And Juan is also on the board of the Kauai group of the Sierra Club. And without further ado, Juan is going to talk about the military presence in Hawaii.
Aloha, everybody. there are a couple of maps on the walls. These are three of the same map, so your proximity to them makes it easier to see one or another one. It's actually, these maps were put together from multiple sources. One of them was the area between San Diego and the Hawaiian Island Range Complex. Another is the Mariana Training Complex relative to Hawaii. A third was the monuments and the restricted fishing areas that on land that's American controlled, or U.S. controlled. And one of the reasons I put this map together was to show you the extent and the depth of involvement that the U.S. Navy has all across the Pacific. This is kind of a residue of our winning the Second World War with nuclear bombs. Because all these islands that we fought the Japanese on and later were setting off atomic bombs on, like in the Marianas and in the Marshall Islands, are now places where we have naval monuments for the health and the happiness of the fish that are going to be there and the whales and whatnot. But they kind of overlap with the areas that the Navy does testing in as well. So some people are suspicious about these increases in the size of these monument areas and the restriction of people that are not military going into them, whereas the military are not constrained by the rules that other people are. Anyway, I'm speaking tonight in place of Kuhan Pike, who I'm gonna read this because it's a lot of material. I'll try and get through it. Kuhan planned to make a presentation on the Pacific Ocean pivot that's being made by the United States. I must say that Kuhan works tirelessly on these issues, and she was the first one that brought to my attention the technique that the U.S. has of using small islands as bases to have huge military influences. And it's been going on for quite a while, and it's quite developed in the Pacific. She's knowledgeable of these policies and is very active. I believe she's right now in South Korea and working there on issues that are of immediate importance. Anyway, Kuhan's presentation for this panel 2 years ago, I think, was very pertinent, and I think it was prescient when you hear some of the details that she mentioned then, which may be, I think, have influence now. She said at the time, the U.S. is attempting to stake its claim on the Asian Pacific region. Hillary Clinton, a huge cheerleader for militarization, has called the 21st century America's Pacific Century. RIMPAC is only a small piece of the huge systematized federal project of destruction called the Pacific Pivot. The Pacific Pivot is a plan to reorient the U.S. military away from Europe and the Middle East and towards the Asian Pacific area. We are now in its beginning stages. New bases are being built. New military agreements are being forged with Pacific Rim nations. The PMRF is ramping up for more rocket launches. The obnoxious Osprey helicopters are coming to Hawaii, and huge swaths of the ocean have been targeted by the Pentagon for continual year-round bombing and detonations. Our region is now witnessing the acceleration of militarization that resembles all-out war. And from an environmental point of view, it is no different from all-out war, because the training exercise is rife with every kind of explosion imaginable, never stop. Even the PMF, and I believe he's a former commander now, even the PMRF commander Hay bragged, our ability to train like we would actually fight exists here. We in Hawaii are at the center of this ecocide. We're not only at the center geographically, we're also the center of its control. And that was the last part of my quote of her. In 2014, during the same panel discussion, I said, in recent decades, several weapon systems have been developed and tested from the PMRF here on Kauai. Those systems include submarine-based ballistic missiles with nuclear warheads. The PMRF is the wheelhouse for many of these activities. The ocean reefs, beaches, dunes, valleys, plains are strewn with lead, depleted uranium, as well as pollutants such as bilge oil, hydraulic fluids, defoliants, and countless other contaminants used in war and in war games. RIMPAC is a demonstration to our partners and enemies that we will do anything to maintain military control over the vastness of the Pacific Ocean. Well, that was then in 2014. This is now. And a point I would like to make this evening is that what maintains America's domination of the Pacific are not alliances and trade agreements. I don't think it's even RIMPAC and war games. The power lies in the strategic military bases we maintain throughout the Pacific that are the muscles that allow those alliances and trade deals and policies to be enforced. And the force that runs through those muscles is delivered through nuclear power reactors and nuclear weapons. Nuclear power propels about 100 nuclear submarines and leads 10 nuclear strike groups with access to thousands of state-of-the-art nuclear weapons. During RIMPAC 2016, one of those carrier groups will be leading 45 ships and 4 submarines through the Hawaiian Islands. My case to you tonight is that the United States' domination through the Pacific during the last 70 years rests on two foundations, nuclear reactors and nuclear weapons. According to globalsecurity.org, the mission of the PMRF is to facilitate training tactics, development, test evaluations for air, surface, subsurface weapon systems, and advanced technology systems. The PMRF will be a crucial asset in the coordination, communication, telemetry, intelligence, evaluation, and recording of the events during RIMPAC 2016, and any future Pacific war as well. The map I brought with me is an update of the map I put. I won't go through that, but the red outline in these maps identifies the boundaries of millions of square miles of range complex. Now, somebody once came at me and said, we don't have millions. Well, this is normally what people think of as the range that is the test done in the Hawaiian area, but it's actually about 2 million square miles. The Hawaiian Island Range Complex is a huge rectangle taking up a huge part of the Central Pacific. There's another range facility here which coordinates when they do rocket and missiles experiments from San Diego. They come across, there's another range here for weapons, and then there's a second transit corridor here which goes all the way to the Marianas. So when they're testing intercontinental ballistic missiles, they're testing space vehicles, they're testing various weapon systems, the PMRF in the middle here can coordinate all across the Pacific through these ranges various aspects of these tests. Lynn McNutt is on the Western Pacific Regional Fishery Management Council, which is a NOAA organization that has regulation of American territorial fishing. She recently said, the military is not subject to any of the conservation rules, and by allowing them to operate sonar in the monument area and continue missile launches at sea, the conservation rules are meaningless. Recently, the PMRS has been expanding its territorial restrictions on fishermen due to rocket firing and missile testing that they're doing. It is the proposal of the Marine Monument boundary of the northwestern Hawaiian Island area to expand to 200 miles. And if it did so from Niihau Island, which is, we did have a slide, but the next island up from Niihau is Nihoa. If they get to make that 200-mile expansion from the one they have now, it'll actually intersect Kauai and Niihau, and it will make it impossible for fishermen to move through that area. It'll also mean you can't pass between Niihau and Kauai if you aren't properly licensed to do so. Since there's talk of making the PMRF an active military base, and since the test activity took place in an expanded range restriction area, she said, fishermen are very concerned that the expanded military will result in further restrictions for fishermen. Let's look at the American treatment of the ocean since World War II. Starting in 1946, America and its allies, Britain and France, conducted what in effect was an extended nuclear war in the Pacific Ocean. This involved detonating over 160 nuclear devices on, near, or under the ocean, on islands near them or underneath the ocean. This included Bikini Island, Baker Island, and at Tewak Island, Christmas Island, Johnson Island. And the 12 nuclear devices they set off on Johnson Island were about 700 miles away from here. The skies were lit up. The skies were lit up on Maui. This was up until 1961, I believe it was. It was just before the test ban treaty. And the people who were coordinating that, PMRF people, it wasn't quite called the PMRF there then, but let's see. While the British conducted 20 nuclear tests, the French did 40, the United States did over 100. And a lot of them were big yields. We're talking about 15 megaton bombs with a total of about 210 million tons of TNT. And this was set off on reefs, it vaporized harbors, atolls. In two or three cases, islands were actually occupied by people and they weren't even told these blasts were going to go off. I mean, not right onto over their heads, but close enough that waves came across islands. People were, you know, later evacuated, but I wanted to see what would happen. I have a little history of our place out here, the PMRF. It was about 56 that the Navy first had any interest here. They negotiated with Bonham Air Force Base, which was out there, to get 37 acres of land. They had a five-year deal on it. By 62, the PMRF had become the principal user of Bonham Air Force Base, and they began to transfer the base to the Navy. But by that time, cows in Wisconsin were like chewing up grass and giving strontium-90 in their milk. And if you remember, Jacqueline Kennedy got very upset about it. I don't know if you're old enough to remember this. And she whispered in Jack's ear and said, don't do that anymore. I just had a miscarriage. Don't do that anymore. and they actually stopped all those atmospheric tests. But those tests were going off just out in the air and drifting over the United States and coming down to Wisconsin and everywhere else. But by that time, the PMRF had established this chain of stations across the Pacific and this network of telecommunications that it still has. One of the things that they started doing there in the late 60s and early 70s was developing the new generations of nuclear weapons, like the Trident, the submarine-based nuclear missiles carrying nuclear bombs. These facilities were crucial, the PMRF, in the development and testing of submarine-launched nuclear weapons like the Trident and Tomahawk. The Trident is a high-altitude ballistic missile with multiple independently targetable reentry bombs. So that it, if you remember the MIRVs, they were very concerning because they have about a 6,000-mile range. Each one of those rockets can drop multiple nuclear weapons anywhere in the world. And those were tested out here in the PMRF in these ranges that they've got for submarines to come in and measure shock waves and do all these things they had to do. Also, the Tomahawk missiles were developed here. These are the ones that fly low, carry nuclear weapons, and can steer themselves through the terrain under radar and take a missile somewhere. Beginning in 68, the Navy started building the Nimitz-class carriers. These were nuclear-powered carriers that led these strike groups that we're talking about and would launch nuclear missiles from planes and bombs that could reach anywhere on Earth. Beginning in the 70s, they started building the Ohio-class and Los Angeles-class submarines. And these are submarines that have, again, multiple missiles on them, or MIRVs, vertical takeoff chutes in the tops of them. And they can also silently go anywhere. Well, they don't do it silently, do they? But they can reach anywhere in the ocean and basically destroy any place that they care to do so. So the PRF is now the world's largest, as a result of these developments, multi-dimensional testing and training range. The PMRF is the only range in the world where subsurface, surface, air, and space vehicles can operate and be tracked simultaneously. But since nuclear war was found to be impractical, most nuclear activity in recent decades has turned to building power plants. Asian nuclear power plant building has been aggressive. Needless to say, many U.S. weapons contractors also got involved with nuclear power industry. The American government and corporations pushed nuclear power technology on allies and defeated enemies. In the 1970s, lightweight reactors were built in Japan with the help of General Electric and Westinghouse, and these are the ones that have given us a little bit of a problem recently. Some of those American nuclear technology contractors, besides Westinghouse and General Electric, are Bechtel, Babcock, Wilcox, Nuclear Fuel Services, Northrop Grumman, General Dynamics, Huntington Ingalls, Lockheed Martin. They're all out at the PMRF. I see the PMRF as more or less an industrial park that's managed by guys in white suits that happen to be in the Navy. ITT does the security. The Navy does, the military doesn't even do their own security. It's ITT. So it's really an industrial park for these guys to develop new generations of weapons. And one of the last ones they developed there was the Aegis missile system. And you're probably aware of this, but they have been firing Aegis missiles there for a while. They now want to make it a permanent Aegis missile base and turn the PMRF from being a research facility into a permanent military base. Here's the question. Which came first, the reactor or the bomb? Well, it's the reactors that came first. Ex-World War II President Dwight D. Eisenhower, who was a general that helped win the Second World War, proposed in 1953 that nuclear energy be used for peace instead of war. He proposed the Atoms for Peace program that would transform power of the atom to make electricity instead of weapons. It would also give many large military industrial corporations something to do if they weren't conducting war. In the early 50s, it was recognized that the weapons programs would require more plutonium than could be furnished by the Atomic Energy Commission. One suggestion made by Charles A. Thomas, then executive vice president of Monsanto Corporation, was to create a dual-purpose plutonium reactor that could produce plutonium for weapons and electricity for commercial use. The Atoms for Peace program created an ideological background for the creation of the International Atomic Energy Commission, for a treaty non-proliferation of nuclear weapons, but also gave political cover for the U.S. nuclear weapons buildup and the backdrop to the Cold War arms race. Under the Atoms for Peace program, the U.S. exported 25 tons of highly enriched uranium to 30 countries, mostly for fuel, for research reactors. This is now regarded as proliferation and a terrorism risk, this kind of activity. Nuclear reactors are needed to make the material for nuclear bombs. The U.S. is in a dominating position throughout the world as a result of this process. In addition, nuclear reactor power those things that deliver the bombs, like the carriers and the nuclear submarines. So these two engineering disciplines are joined at the hip. One is needed by the other for their survival. Our former enemy and current ally, Japan, has suffered from both disciplines. They are unfortunately have the distinction of being the victims of the two worst nuclear catastrophes in history. As an enemy in 1945, Japan suffered having two cities being destroyed by atomic bombs within days of one another. An ally, it suffers now from the worst nuclear meltdown in history. Following the March 11th, 2011 earthquake and tsunami, there was a complete meltdown of three of the six reactors supplied by General Electric to Fukushima Daiichi. Put in perspective, the destruction and radiation sickness caused by a single atomic bomb that landed on Hiroshima was generated with only a few pounds of uranium. Moreover, in the case of Fukushima reactor number three, the amount of material in the melted reactors was about 600 pounds each, which is about 1,800 pounds of material. So that's 900 times more radioactive material in those three meltdowns. The case of Fukushima Reactor 3 is reported that despite regulations, the fuel that was used there was mixed oxide, or MOX fuel, which is about 7% plutonium. It's a lot more toxic than uranium and considerably longer in its half-life. In the 1960s, if you might remember the older timers here, President Nixon proposed that we build breeder reactors using MOX fuel. Now, as I understand it, it was not by the nuclear regulation of international or the Japanese agencies to allow MOX fuel to be used in that reactor. This is being done on the sly. The problem is that when these three blew up, the one that had the MOX fuel in it went through a criticality, and it's on video. It's a big black plume that comes out of it. That fuel, it was left in those things, has burned through. Well, the USS Reagan was nearby when the meltdown occurred, and they were offshore when the two reactors 2 and 3 blew up. They were downwind of the plutonium that came out of that criticality, and many of you may be familiar with what happened to the Reagan. But let's see. There was other parts of the carrier group that was there. Let's see if I can find where I'm lost. Let me get back to this. Ah, here we go. This is from Lindsay Cooper, Navy sailor aboard the USS Ronald Reagan. I was standing on the flight deck, and we felt this warm gust of air. And suddenly, it was snowing. We joked about it. Hey, it's radioactive snow. I took pictures and video. Japan didn't want us in port after that. Korea wouldn't take us. Guam turned us away. We floated in the water for 2.5 months with diarrhea. People were shitting all over the hallways. On top of that, the Reagan had replenished its water tanks that it desalinated for washing, cooking, and drinking. It did not realize the water contained radioactive elements. So these sailors on board the ship, even after they're traveling around trying to find a port to get into, are drinking water from these tanks that they had. Since 2011, about 400 young, healthy service persons from the carrier group have become unexplainably ill. Several have died. The USS Reagan was severely contaminated. It was taken out of service in dry dock for 18 months in Bremerton, Washington, in order to decontaminate it. The ship was back on duty in time for flagship, as the flagship of the 2014 RIMPAC exercises. After the war games, the Reagan was reassigned from San Diego to Yokosuka, Japan. And I find that almost sadistic. I mean, it's just mind-boggling to me. Participants of RIMPAC 2016 include Canada, Chile, China, India, Indonesia, Japan, Malaysia, New Zealand, Norway, Peru, Singapore, South Korea, Tonga, and the United States. It also includes three NATO allies, France, Germany, and the Netherlands. And it seems ominous to me that NATO allies are participating in RIMPAC. NATO is now pushing hard against the Russians over territory in Eastern Europe. We're doing full court press here, obviously, over the state of things in the South China Sea. But to have NATO involved in RIMPAC, I think, is truly an ominous thing. Does anyone here remember CETO? The Southeast Asia Treaty Organization, CETO, was in effect after the Korean War and was used through the Vietnam War to keep friendly nations on the same page with us. But after America lost the Vietnam War, CETO withered away and was disbanded by 1977. There's been a heating up of Chinese sovereignty claims in the South China Sea, and it's my suspicion that RIMPAC is a preview with NATO in it of a kind of rebuilding of CETO, which, again, it didn't go well for us the first time when we went to Vietnam fighting with CETO. What are the real strategic priorities that we have? If it is not obvious yet, it should be soon, that there's only so much more easily obtained conventional energy in the form of gas, oil, and coal. These three sources are critical for modern industrial civilization. They are crucial for refining steel, aluminum, other metals. They are also a source of material for creating asphalts, plastics, fertilizers, insulation, pharmaceuticals, lubricants. They are the source of 75% of the energy we use. Now we know, however, that burning all these available fossil fuels is causing uncontrollable global warming with climate change and rising oceans. We're already experiencing the bow waves of these effects. We must be very judicial in determining what we do with these resources. One thing to consider is that without abundant available gas, oil, and coal, we cannot safely maintain operating the world's 500 nuclear power plants, and it's likely without massive effort starting now, we will not even be able to safely shut them down. There's also more than 15,000 nuclear warheads in the world that need safe decommissioning, and the U.S. has more than 7,000 of them. I don't know if you've heard of the WIP location. It's many may not realize it, but this facility, which was called the Waste Isolation Pilot Plant in New Mexico, was the only facility in the country for taking nuclear waste. It seems that before shipping, technicians at Los Alamos National Labs packed a 55-gallon steel drum with waste plutonium and the wrong kind of kitty litter. And they literally used kitty litter, but it was the wrong kind of kitty litter. It packs, you know, they fill the barrel up with it. It ignited a fire. It was a plutonium fire, and it couldn't be put out, and who knew? You know, the atomic scientists didn't know how to deal with it. Now there's no place in the U.S. to process stored nuclear weapons. And I remember when this WIP thing first went off, there was nuclear waste in transit from Washington State, from various places, that had to stop in place in trucks and not have any place to go. How's that? Wrap it up. Okay. Okay, here's the priorities I would set. Tackle the problem of hundreds of tons of highly radioactive water entering the Pacific daily from Fukushima. This is something the Navy ought to have top on its priority list. Commit whatever is required to saving ocean reefs from acidification and bleaching, another job for the Navy. Strictly enforce international regulations to keep fisheries sustainable and healthy. Take care of the gigantic Pacific gyres of plastic, flotsam, and jetsam, and rescue Pacific Islanders threatened by rising seas. Thank you for your time.
Yeah, all right, so who wants to go first? Any thoughts or questions?
One, is your presentation or any part of it, the information available on Island Breath?
It's going to be tomorrow.
On Island Breath?
It will be tomorrow. There's about 15 or 20 copies of the text over there, which I couldn't even follow myself as I was saying it, but it's written out over there.
On the table, there are copies. And some of the math, copies of the math.
And I want to thank Juan because Kuhan really was the one instigating this event. And then she's in the Marianas right now.
Oh,
she's filming a documentary. They're about to blast Pagan, which is a now uninhabited, beautiful island. So she chose to do that because it's so dreadful. Thanks.
I don't know. this too, but I heard from someone last night that there are people coming here and being relocated here from another island that has been bombed. Does anybody know anything about this?
Is this a recent bombing you're speaking about?
Well, I don't know if it's recent or not. I just heard that they're relocating a whole bunch of people from this island to Kauai because they can't inhabit that island anymore. And I assume it's the Navy.
Not a whole bunch of people, but I remember this is happening to people of the islands that are... This has been going on for decades, relocation of people. And they're trying
to Kauai?
Go, not to Kauai, but maybe to even Oahu. And if there any, it was some tiny number here, not many, but this is...
So she has said they're coming into her neighborhood, like in droves. and I do not know which neighborhood it is.
No.
I mean, she told me
that.
Right.
The United States military has used the Mariana Islands as target practice, and it has destroyed much of the atolls in some of these islands. That has forced the people to come here.
Right. Well, right. You're saying that the U.S. has destroyed the islands, so people can't fish there.
Can
they can't do their livelihood.
Their independence and sovereignty has been destroyed by the U.S. military, which has forced them to come to the Hawaiian Islands, and they've got some kind of deal now where they can come here for medical care, and it's horrible, you know. And they are on the bottom of our society, you know, and. They have to take the lowest paying jobs. Many of them end up unemployed or homeless, you know, and they have dozens of cancers and diseases because of our military testing in the Pacific. And it's a real tragedy, and this story somehow has to come out.
It's actually through even World War II. I went to Chuuk, which is a famous dive spot because people like to dive on plane wrecks.
Yeah.
And shipwrecks, and it was paved. And this is the story. Many islands across the Pacific were paved. They moved the people, they cut down the palm trees, and they built military hopping points to get over to Okinawa. It's a terrible, terrible history. When I was in Tahiti in 1985 at the Coral Reef Conference, at the end of the conference, 500 marine biologists are there, and a gentleman in the back got up at the public event, and he said, "I'm a grandfather from Moorea, that's the next island over, Tahiti. After you leave, the French are going to resume nuclear testing," and that would be 1985. And he said, "Do you have a comment? Because I'm worried about the corals and the fishes and my grandchildren." And I was so dismayed that the head of the Coral Reef Conference said, "Oh, I'm sorry, we're not into politics, we're biologists." And I walked out, I was so upset. We just are blind to it. The earth is alive. Water is alive. We're destroying it. We are obliterating life on this planet, and the scientists are studying the data still.
Well, the point is that the U.S. militarism has created refugees.
Yes.
Out of Pacific Islanders.
Yes.
And they're not stealing our jobs. They're not stealing our homes. You know, they're refugees from militarism created by our country. And that's why they're coming to the Hawaiian Islands. And people got to know that. Mm-hmm. And they need assistance and help.
I'll call on people.
Thank you.
Sure.
Sorry.
Go ahead.
Paul.
So, on that note, we don't know what the effects of the militaristic activities could be affecting us, even. Mm-hmm. Though, in a certain way, we might be refugees, so how can we, the people of this state and this country, actually do what Okinawa did and just try to say, close that base? We don't even want this military on this island. Is there any, any chance of that? Or
that's why I came.
Can enough people get together and realize what it is? Because, I have heard that there's high intensity microwaves that might be affecting us and everything, all life under sea and on top. And we will be refugees before we know it if we don't stand up, maybe. I don't know.
All of us have to do it. What's so exciting about Okinawa is that it's 85% of the people They went through the war, and they're not backing down. They are so determined. They're inviting me back in March to dive again and speak with the parliament. And I go, they already have a plan for March? You know, they're really together. And this is so we have to do that here. And this is, we have so many petty arguments on this island that I don't know that it's possible, but we have to do this.
Yeah, I just want to say, when they were doing RIMPAC 2 years ago, we were at Polahalli, and we could see the warships going back and forth and the explosions and hear it. And, you know, I would go talk to everybody I could at the beach, and majority of people were like, no, this is what it is to be a free American. We have to have the military doing this stuff. And I just felt like, I don't even know what to say. I feel frustrated how to even talk to the regular public about it.
I'm going to comment on your comment. And I live out in Kekaha by the base, and lots of people think there's 1,000 jobs there. Well, in fact, those 1,000 jobs are people who live in California. They don't live here. There are very, very few local jobs there. There's a subway out there, and there's a gas station out there, and there's computers. But there are very few jobs. And that's an argument that our county council gives about how wonderful the base is because they're West Side jobs. Well, you know, I'm sorry. I see the people from Lockheed come into Kekaha and they stay for 3 months and they work 7 days a week to blow up a missile and they're gone. It's not a job generator. And I think that's a very important issue for all of us. Whenever we hear Joanne Yukimura say, oh, it's West Side jobs, you know, Joanne needs to be taken down. No, they're not. They're California jobs. They're Arizona jobs. And also, I want to also add that it was on the base closure list during the Clinton years, and Inouye stepped in and saved it. And we need to get rid of that base. That is not an asset for our community. Where I live, I can watch a missile go off, and it's sound effect. I'm glad it goes over the ocean. Did you plan that, Gordon? So yeah, we need to get rid of that base. It's not just RIMPAC, but we need to get rid of the Pacific Missile Range facility.
Aren't they talking about really expanding the base,
They were talking about it, then they pulled back and denied it. But
did they really?
Yeah.
No, I heard it just got major funding. It was, I think it got sent out by Brian Schatz.
They fund projects.
Right.
They do
massive
it.
Funding for like this year.
It's a project by project funding. Like Juan said, it's an industrial park. That's what it is.
Mm-hmm. Do they have nuclear weapons there? Nuclear. I'm talking about nuclear power.
There is a Sandia Labs office out there.
Yeah.
Sandia Labs was one of the organizations started by the federal government to develop those kind of technologies. And I don't exactly know what Sandia Labs does out there, but they do run reactors, for example, on the mainland, experimental reactors and things like that.
I mean, Paul Sara mentioned DARPA.
Yeah.
That is all DARPA out there. It's all stuff with, it's all secret. And what did you say it's off?
It's not part of the military. It's its own entity that reports directly to the Defense Department, and they're not beholden to the rules of the military. And so they, do you remember a few years ago, I think it was 2006, two baby humpback whales and thousands of deep sea squid washed ashore on the west side? Well, that was a DARPA experiment the day before. There was no public comment. There was no EIS. There was no permit. And they were testing an underwater rocket that's supposed to go really fast. And they had to create an explosion loud enough to generate a bubble around the missile. And that's what...
Super cavitation was the technology. Where you actually have the torpedo essentially in a gas bubble for the resistance of water.
Right.
And it creates a shockwave in front of it, kind of like a sound burst. And it's crushing anything in front of it. Because it's going faster than the speed of sound through
there,
the water.
There was no consequence. There was no an open admission to it. We found out under the Freedom of Information Act that it was there.
Now, another thing I found out, this is a document that's kind of part of an advertisement brochure for people that might want to use the PMRF for various purposes. And it shows three major, this is Kauai here, and the PMRF is this little yellow thing. You probably can't see it from there. But it shows three major sonar array stations and measuring stations. And the middle one, which is probably about 40 miles off the shore, off of Polihali, it's called Barster. This was the first one they had built. In the middle of it, they say something, they point to an arrow to a little yellow thing called Fake Island. Fake Island. Now, I don't know if this is a simulation on a computer or a simulation of reflection of sound in the ocean. But they're doing some weird things out there. Fake Island.
In your best guesstimate, how many jobs do you think are out there? Because, yes, the county council does use that as a reason for why it should remain.
They say, right, tourism is number one, military is two. I mean, they make it seem like it's a very big compound.
Well, how many jobs?
Yeah, you can only guess, but there's only about a dozen soldiers. We call it the base. There's hardly any soldiers there. Like you said, the guards are
ITT.
Or Pinkerton.
No, ITT.
But there are some permanent jobs out there. You know, the cafeteria workers and Shenanigans restaurants and things like that. My personal guess is there's probably 50 jobs out there. But the number 1,000 comes from these consultants. And they spend some money on the island.
But not much.
I watch them. They go to work at 7 in the morning and they come home at 10 at night. So they're not spending money on tour boats and helicopters. They're
actually misallocating a lot of money, too. If you remember, they built two, on the west side, they built these two West Technology Centers out there, two buildings out there, which were going to be used for some people's offices. There's going to be used for the public in some ways. Basically, those buildings are failures out there. They're very underutilized. They just sit there air conditioning with nothing going on. They built a command and control center for the Pacific right next to the mall, if you remember that. What was it called?
Solipsis.
And it was the most Daniel, anyway, when he was still alive, went there to cut the ribbon when they built the place. And after he cut the ribbon, he said, I guess I'm not authorized to be here anymore. It was that top secret. But it was a war room. It was a war room like they had out in Abu Dhabi, wherever it was, when they do the war in Iraq, where the press could come and they could show them these big screens and all this stuff. And it was very convenient because the middle school was there. You could buy a nice house next to the mall and go to Costco. It was a suburban war room. And it was probably more successful in some ways, at least as a lifestyle, than the base. Shenanigans is pathetic. But it collapsed. It went away. It disappeared. And I'm hoping that that's what happens with the PMRF eventually. But the U.S. is going to be so broke getting through the next 20 years, they can't afford to do this stuff anymore.
A lot of the money, though, comes from institutions like Stanford and MIT that can bring, part of the deal, they come and bring their stuff to test, and then they leave it there. I met the two guys that were doing that parachute. Remember the parachute that was going to...
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, they were in town, and I said, oh, it was during RIMPAC, and I said, what do you think about RIMPAC? And they looked at me blankly. They are just doing parachute. They didn't know about RIMPAC. They didn't care. And it's the strangest set of people. But it's a lot of, like, MIT-type money goes over there.
People on the west side that I know that work there are people that are like draftsmen, some administrative people, secretarial people, for just general office work out there. And they kind of subbed out to some of those companies that are out there. But they're not high-paying engineering jobs, mostly.
Yeah, maybe some of them might live here a year, sometimes even a year and a half. And then, you know, when the project runs out of cash, they close down the thing, and that's the end, and they go home. But they're, you know, so that it's just a lie that there are 1,000 jobs out there. It's just a lie. And, well, it's a distortion of the truth.
Harry.
Just a comment, and I don't want to bug everyone, because everyone knows I bug everybody. just to no end. I do have some valid information that I would love to share with you all if you would like to see the valid information. And in 2012, Congress adopted PMFR is to be the microwave warfare base of planet Earth to replace nuclear warfare.
Yeah, what you said about the babies is very scary.
So in our everyday life, as we're walking around here on Hawaii, how is this affecting our health?
Well, I'm fearful and makes me sick. I'm depressed. That's a huge thing. Just knowing about it is really scary because it's hard to deal with. And I need to be around people like you.
Does it heat up your brain?
I would have to.
I'm going to take that question.
Okay.
I'm a medical doctor. I'm a retired medical doctor. I think it's important to look at health holistically, and that the overwhelming, most important aspect of your health is your diet. And the second is your exercise. And the third is the stress. And the fourth are your bad habits if you smoke or drink alcohol. And when you put those things up there, the effects of the base are negligible on your daily health. I do think that the diet, if those of you who eat fish are taking risks, but probably not from the base per se. God only knows what DARPA does out there and all that electromagnetic stuff and blah, blah, blah. But I think it's the reason to get rid of the base is not our everyday health. Mm-hmm. I mean, unless you're worried about long-term nuclear war kind of everyday health. But
yeah, Gordon,
that you're, again, I don't want to get into a back and forth here, but your greatest exposure to microwave radiation, in my view, is your cell phone. And talking on your cell phone for long periods of time, putting that thing right next to your brain, is probably dangerous, but it's not as dangerous as drinking milk or smoking cigarettes or eating meat or not exercising, but it is dangerous.
That's my take on it. I have neighbors that our last RIMPAC, 2014, they're a very sensitive family, and they've been measuring the smart meters and the EMFs that come from the smart meters. And they said that all summer long, it was just exponential how much radiation there was. And you know, they think, you know, we don't know for sure, that somehow the microwaves and all the activity from RIMPAC was magnifying through the smart meters. But there are many, many health effects. In fact, there were a lot of people who had strokes during RIMPAC. There were a lot of people mm-hmm. who had heart seizures during RIMPAC. So, you know, I wouldn't just brush it off. I think there's a lot that we don't know.
I agree, and during the smart meter campaign, I use the expression that electromagnetic radiation might be the new cigarettes, because we don't know. And we're bathed in electromagnetic radiation. Unbelievable. Your Wi-Fis, your landline phones are electromagnetic, your microwave ovens, your cell phones. I don't think we should get in a debate about electromagnetic radiation. I think we should stick to RIMPAC and war games. So I'm going to kind of ask for other subjects, because we can get bogged down.
Yeah.
Any other comments?
I just have a question. Last 2 days, I've noticed that there's a some kind of a military operation set up in the school right at the top of Woolahanna. Is that related to RIMPAC, or are we doing the healthcare?
That's Tropic Care, Kauai. And I looked, because I always assumed it was part of RIMPAC, because it's always exactly at the same time.
Right.
And there's nothing in writing that I could find that it's officially part of RIMPAC. But its mission is the same, just through the medical field. It's the doctors from all walks of all the military branches coming together and training on how to work together. And so they're using Kauai to train on. But it's always right before RIMPAC. And it's the same. So even though it's not official,
I think it's also to soften the blow. You know, we don't really want the military out there, but they do all this good stuff. They look at your teeth and your eyes for free.
Conditioning, yeah.
I think if your eyes are open, you're going to see RIMPAC events or pre-events going on. I've seen them going on the west side for a month or two. Not long ago, I was in Kamapepe on the Kamapepe River, and a Zodiac came zooming up the river, went under the highway bridge, then went under the one-lane bridge, and landed at a little kayak put in place right by where the levee starts. And these guys jump out, you know, they're kind of dressed in gray and white khaki and whatnot. They sort of spread out a little bit around the levee. No guns. I think what they were doing is they were just testing coming in to see if when they do a landing there this summer, what the lay of the land was. I remember last year I saw a destroyer come in off the ocean towards Kamapepe Harbor. Again, two Zodiacs come out, and they went right through the harbor, did a little landing thing, went back out, probably in a half an hour, in and out, thing like that. So they're already practicing or setting up their situations on the island that they might be doing. And there will be landings on this island of troops doing various things. There'll be helicopters coming over from Oahu. There'll be a number of things going on. And I've seen planes in the air, other things. Again, the activity's already started.
Yeah.
And they do landings over at Major's Bay. They actually, and they drive over the reefs and all that stuff. Major's Bay is mostly sand, but there's reefs there too. They just run them up.
Speaking of reefs, I forgot to mention, these corals that are 2,000 and 4,000 years old, Lophelia reefs off North Carolina are 50,000 years old. The reefs themselves, an individual bush might be 1,000 years old. They've been growing for 50,000 years there. So I feel this is very much similar to my own life. In my childhood, everything was beautiful in the ocean, and in 65 years, it's all dying. And so 50,000 years of corals are obliterated by just a few years of RIMPAC and the military activities. We're talking about long, 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 long time changing quickly. That's what's terrifying to me. And we have... people need to know. I've talked to so many people this week on the beach, over in town. RIMPAC? What's that? Mm-hmm. They don't know. People who were born here, people who are visiting. It's unbelievable.
Is there a way to stop it?
Sure.
Join us.
Get involved. Our decision makers, our federal decision makers, think that citizens of Hawaii support the military.
Yeah.
You talk to them. All of them think that it's good for the Hawaii economy, it brings us jobs, blah, blah, blah. And we need to tell those decision makers that we don't want the military, that we don't want war, we don't want war preparations, we don't want war games. And, you know, that's what we're doing with this Oceans4Peace campaign. Out there we have a petition, a paper petition, but it's on change.org. We just started it yesterday, and it's already cooking. We're sending letters to the decision makers. We have to educate our friends and neighbors, because as Katie says.
We'll talk about your event, please. We're going to have a sign waving.
Me? Are you?
No. I'm sorry, I forgot your name.
Yes.
Carrie.
Yeah.
We will
direct
having,
action.
Yes, we will be having a small march in Kaha'a. Date most likely next
It's next Saturday.
Saturday.
It's from 9 to noon, and you can come for a half hour. Or you can come the whole time and bring a sign, RIMPAC Impact, RIMPAC, Stop RIMPAC, whatever you want to say. We'll have handouts about our other activities that are going on. And we'll be talking to people and telling them about RIMPAC.
So next Saturday in front of Safeway.
I think also I met a young woman named Tori today. I'm very happy to see young people in the audience. We need young people. She suggested we do this again maybe over at the Kava Hut, you know, get more people, especially young people, mm-hmm. on this island involved. This is so important. Because like Bernie Sanders' campaign, it really took off. You know, there's some incredibly vigorous youth that have their heads on right, you know. So it's not, I 2 years ago, I just felt hopeless, and this year's Oceans4Peace was 5 times more people than 2 years ago, and so here we go. Okinawa's problems were exacerbated by a rape last month, and so everybody's angry, and that it's been years of their protests, but it's come to a very forceful stage.
Couple more questions.
I don't have any questions, but I have an Oceans4Peace events that are focused around children. Mm-hmm. And we have a group of individuals within Oceans4Peace. And I'm one of them. Robin Mazur is one of them. Robert is over there. And Marcy and Sandy Herndon. So we are showing a movie, a Disney movie at Hanapepe on Saturday the 9th. If anyone lives in the Hanapepe West Side area. And in conjunction with the movies, we're having children's activities. So that is part of the Oceans4Peace activities and presentations. On July 17th, we'll be at the Kapa'a Neighborhood Center. And at the movies, we again do postcards that the children do their art on. And then we mail it to our representatives in Honolulu and Washington, D.C. So Marcy is one of them, I'm one of them, Robert's one of them, and Robin and Robert are the people that if you're interested in children's activities, we would love to have you help us. We're also doing at Lydgate and Hanalei at the bays there, at the children's. Probably we haven't fixed on a date. Oh, yes, we have. Sunday, the 3rd of July, we will be in Hanalei, and probably at 10 o'clock. So Robin is in charge of that one. If you want to help out and be there at 10 o'clock in Hanalei, talk to Robin. And if you want to help out in Hanapepe on the 9th, of July, talk to me. And Marcy and Robert are also part of them. So those people who want to be involved in children's activities, talk to the four of us.
And also direct action, we have a whole committee. So if you want to get into the direct action committee, you can talk to me or Carrie. We'll be doing other events. We might go out to the missile base during the 4th of July fireworks. I think it'd be very apropos.
Yeah. Well, Oceans4Peace is a coalition. I'm going to name the groups. Kohola, Surfrider Foundation, the Sierra Club, Kauai Alliance for Peace and Justice, Code Pink, and Reef Guardians Hawaii. So it's put together around RIMPAC per se, and we'll probably close it up after RIMPAC. But for those of you who can't remember just what all the lists that Mary just said, you can sign the Kohala email mailing list, and you'll get notices from us through that list. Also, you'll get noted if you're on the Surfrider Foundation mailing list, you'll get notices from them.
It's on the calendar, too. There's a calendar on oceansforpeace.org.
Our website, yes. Yes. So, yeah, so stay involved and get educated, and please come next Friday here to the Sonic Scene movie. I think you'll really enjoy it. It's a very well done movie, and it's very educational, and it's really important. It's about ocean noise in general and Navy sonar in specific. So, okay, I'm going to take one last question, and then we're going to close it up.
Okay, I know everybody's schedule is really jammed up, but is anybody going to be doing the manifest next weekend, like a booth or information or a petition drive or?
That's a good idea. I'll look into that.
I'll join you.
Okay.
You
okay.
All right. Well, thanks everybody for coming. And we'll start.